Our scripture lesson today is from John chapter 1. And for those of you who came from upstairs, this sermon is the same sermon I preached last week at Taiwanese worship, because I share some of my background and my own testimony. And I thought that it would be nice for you guys to hear it as well down here. It's from John chapter 1, verses 29 to 42. And my own testimony really shaped my my way of evangelism and my way of reaching out to other people. And so I hope through my testimony you will be encouraged to do the same. John chapter 1, verses 29 to 42. The next day he saw Jesus coming toward him and declared, Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, after me comes a man who ranks ahead of me, because he was before me. I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that I might be revealed to Israel. And John testified, I saw the Spirit descending from him, from heaven, like a dove. It remained on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, he on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. And I myself have seen and testified that this is the Son of God. The next day, John again was standing with two of his disciples. And as he watched, Jesus walked by. John the Baptist said, look, here is the Lamb of God. The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he asked, what are you looking for? They said to him, Rabbi, which meant teacher. Where are you staying? Jesus asked. He said to them, come and see. They came and saw where he was and staying, and they remained with him that day. That it was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. One of the two who heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his brother Simon and said to him, we have found the Messiah. He brought Simon to Jesus, who looked at him and said, you are Simon, son of John. You are to be called Cephas. Word of God for the people of God. For those of you who have not heard us playing the American Spiritual, I love American Spiritual. The first time as an immigrant myself, I came to the United States when I was 11 years old. And the first time I ever listened and heard African American Spiritual was at choir. I joined the choir because supposedly I loved to sing. I just wanted to try it out, and it became a really good thing for me. So I joined the choir, and we sang a lot of African-American spirituals. I found later on, as I start to study and marry to a conductor, has a lot to do with that, studying these African-American spirituals, that they have not only a lot of spirit, in full sense of that word, but also a lot of meaning. Interesting meaning. They sing it joyfully, even though that we know that their history here in the United States is not exactly a joyful one. They love to sing joyfully. And one of my favorite is Wade in the Water. So if we could switch over that to Sia, thank you. We'll listen to it one more time. And I love this edition. This was sung by kids. Alt tab. Okay, got it. It's okay, this is Wade in the Water. Okay. you. We heard it fully. If you want to hear it, YouTube's full of it. This is a very popular African-American spiritual. But this song, this African-American spiritual song, Wade in the Water, has full of meaning. Let me explain. Water. Okay, what does water mean? What does water mean? In the very spiritual sense, water, for a Christian, water means baptism, right? We baptize with water. So in the spiritual sense, water has a very special meaning. It means renewal. It means redemption. Redeemed, meaning to rescue, to be rescued by Jesus Christ from our lives. In the Old Testament, Israelites at the Red Sea saw and experienced God's redemption. After going over, crossing the Red Sea, they had a new life. So their life became renewed. Red Sea, water. So looking at water, this kind of, it gives them a reminder of water-giving redemption. Jordan River. Again, redemption, renewed, a new life. So for a water, the meaning of water in churches in the spiritual sense, it has a renewal and a sense of redemption. For a African-American Christian, water has different meaning. Not only does it have a meaning of renewal and redemption, it also has a very hurtful and very traumatic meaning. What do I mean by that? How did they get to America? They did not come willingly. They had to cross the ocean. In a ship, often a very rundown ship, in a very dark, dark place. If you've never been on a boat crossing the ocean, you've probably been on a cruise. Those crews are floating island, they're not ships. If you've been on a ship, fishing boat, you just gotta go out in the deep sea, you know the treacherous. How treacherous it could be. Think about crossing the entire Atlantic on those kind of boats. Okay, just think about that. And not only that, they were brought here without unwillingly. So for not only do they have the African-American Christians, not only do water have a meaning of redemption and renewal, it has a traumatic meaning. It had a very hurtful reminder of their history here in America. So when the African-Americans sang, Wade in the Water, this water, they're singing not only as a testament of their past, but also a testament of their presence. They have an opposite meaning. One meaning is that when they were slaves, they were crossing the water to become slaves. But at the same time, water also reminded them of Christ giving them renewal, giving them a new life, giving them hope. So when they say they're doing the water to these African American Christians have a dual meaning like that. Not only that, wade. What does that mean? Wade in the water. What does wading mean? What does wading mean? Walk or just kind of move around, troubling the water just a little bit. As we know, during the Civil War, and at that time when President Lincoln proclaimed that Emancipation Proclamation happened, is that the slaves from the South were free. From the North were free, supposedly. The whole nation was free. But in actuality, the slaves in the South had a better chance if they fled to the North. How did they get to the North? Did they have a train? No, I don't think they have a train. There's no train that would send them to the North. How did they get in the North? They had to walk. They had to travel many, many, many days. Part of the American history is that some on the way would help these slaves escape. They would build tunnels. They would build secret passages on the way so that makes these people on the way to the North easier to travel by. Many of these caves or these tunnels will be built by bodies of water and built by the people who are presently slaves there. Okay, so they make these their brothers and sisters easier way to travel to the north. And as they would work in the field, a runaway slave would come. And they would see him or her, and want to help him or her to escape. But they couldn't because they were working and there was probably a boss nearby, a manager nearby. They can't go up there and say, oh, go that way, go that way. They will never be able to do that. So what would they do? They would actually hide secret messages in their songs. They would sing and work at the same time. Wade in the water was part of this, I think, as well. Okay? Wade in the water means to that person who is escaping, you have to wade in the water. Go wade in the water. God's going to trouble that water. Cross that. Once you wade in the water, cross the river, or somehow walk in the river, because there will be a river nearby, you will find the path to freedom. So a lot of songs are like that. Wade in the water is one of them. Okay? So for these people, wading in the water, this song gives them hope. Gives them a way to go. There's another meaning in the wading in the water. Who is the one person that walked on water? Two people, actually. Jesus. And who? Peter. So as they sing wading in the water, not only are reminded that they have this powerful and traumatic past, but they are reminded that Jesus and Peter, Jesus mainly, walked in water. So as they wade in the water to find their freedom, they are reminded as well, Jesus is walking and wading with them. One song with so much meaning to that song as they sang. Because they're full of history and their testimony are full of stories like this. So as they sing their songs to one another, they're sharing these history, they're testifying to one another. In today's scripture, there was another person who testified personally to a person who was close to him. That person's Andrew. Andrew, through John the Baptist, Andrew was a disciple of John the Baptist, heard of this man Jesus, saw him, and then introduced him to Peter. Now, Peter became pretty important in our Christian history. Okay? He is Cephas, he is the rock. But it is through Andrew's testimony and invitation of Andrew that we have Peter. If Andrew didn't share Jesus with Peter, we would never have Peter. Think about that. I know you heard my sermon about 2 weeks ago during this combined service, how I introduced our vision for this year. Our vision for this year is for the people. And I want everybody to do. I want every one of you to think of one person in your life that you want to focus this year your prayer life to, your time to deepen the relationship with, so that in the near future you are able to tell your story to this person. Tell your faith story to this person. I just had a conversation with some of the TM members, Taiwanese ministry members, this morning. In the past, great preachers are wonderful if you want to evangelize. Billy Graham is one of them. But now, in the internet age, any one of you can go online and listen to Billy Graham or anybody else who are great preachers. Great preachers are no longer a good enough draw for people to come to Christ. Now it's all about something you can't get online, a close, personal relationship with a person that you want to reach. Now it's all about that. Why do I say this? Because this is what happened to me. As I said before, 2 weeks ago, I don't even remember, I had one person, a friend of mine, who became Christian later on, but that's because I shared that a story, my testimony at that time when I was 25 with him. I want to share that story with you, okay? And I want to share with you not so that you know my story, Okay, and not only for you to not only for you to know, but also to encourage you to frame your own story. During this year, not only are you to deepen your relationship with another friend of yours, but also to frame your own story, to develop your story. You know your story, but it's a whole different thing to tell it. Trust me on that one. I had to practice telling it, telling my faith story to another person in order for that to be effective when the time comes. When the time comes, it's hard to put it all in words unless you practiced it. So here's my story. Most of you know I came to the United States when I was 11 years old, a lot like Willie. I didn't like it at first. I hated it. I wanted to go back to Taiwan. And it was because some of the youth group, literally, it was the church youth group, their support, I obeyed, and I said, okay, I will stay in the United States. When I was 17 years old, that's how I wanted to stay. Or else we would have moved back probably the year after, because my brother and I were rebelling against my dad and my mom, saying, we don't want to stay. It's too hard to stay. We want to go back. But eventually, we were convinced, and through the support of the church youth group, we stayed, and here I am. Not only that, 17. I had to do, what do when I'm 17? I have to apply for college, right? My English wasn't exactly great. I could talk, converse just fine. But my literary English was not great. My SAT score, my math score was perfect. At that time, there was only two categories. Sorry, guys, you have three now. But at that time, there was two categories, okay? All right, SAT, my math score was perfect, 800, okay? I won't tell you my English score, so, but it was horrible in all the word that horrible means, okay? And for some odd reason, I got accepted to University of Texas. Very odd reason. Very good school. Awesome school. Longhorns. Okay, anyways, they wanted me. And by that time, even though I had to move to Texas, my parents were in California, and I'm moving away from my family in Minnesota, my friends in Minnesota, I said, what the heck, I'll just go. So I just go. I just went. So I obeyed. I went there. 20 years. When I was 20, I was in college. My major was not English. Trust me on that one. They didn't accept me to English department. They accepted me to electrical engineer. My grades weren't bad. They were pretty good. So I was pretty active, not only at school, but also at church. At that time, just because interesting thing had happened, a good friend of mine wanted to go to a retreat, so I followed her to the retreat. I'll put it that way, okay? And what it ended up to be something that I did out of a favor, or actually not a favor for myself, but I wanted to go because of her, ended up that was the place where I received a call to become a minister, to become go to the seminary. Think about this. A college student, okay, who is electrical engineer, whose English test scores were horrible by anybody's standards, okay? God is calling me to be a seminarian, totally 180 degrees turn from my projection for my life. I said, okay, even though how stupid it was, I foolishly obeyed this. Is my testimony. I told my friend, I foolishly obeyed. Every step, even though it is something that I don't think I can do, my testimony, I said to my friend, was that I foolishly obeyed and I just courageously moved. I have today, it is because, this is back in 25, the reason I am here where I am today is because when I was 11 years old, I came to the United States. Even though my English weren't good, they were able to converse, but my parents sacrificed their English so that I could keep my Taiwanese and I could keep my Mandarin on the top back of my mind. I am today because of that. I foolishly obeyed God. God walked with me. If I hadn't foolishly obeyed with God to go to Texas, of all places, while growing up in Minnesota, and my family in California, of all places, I would not have met Reverend John Ye, who was a pastor at Austin at that time, who also encouraged me to go to seminary. And not only that, if I hadn't foolishly obeyed God and courageously moved and agreed to go to seminary, I would not have moved to Princeton later on in my life after my college grad. And it is here in this church, but not exactly in this building, in this church, that I met my wife, Quan Fen, in this church. I would not have met her if I hadn't come to Princeton. I told my friend, and I'm telling you right now, my personal testimony of my life is God has guided me through my foolishly obeying of Him. God is walking with me every step of the way. And I have not changed. And I have kept to that mindset still today. 3 years ago, I foolishly obeyed to come here, even though that would mean separation of family for my family. Just last year, you guys, all of you, foolishly listened to me when I foolishly obeyed my thought of the calling to move us out of a very comfortable situation here at New Brunswick to look for somewhere else to go. I think my testimony, my story, as I tell it today to a friend, any friend that would ask me, what has God done for you, is that God has been blessing me through my foolishly obeying of Him. What I want to ask you is that if you are Andrew, not that Andrew, the Andrew that we read today, if you are Andrew and somebody like Peter, somebody very close to you, come and asks you, what has God done for you? That is your chance, my brothers and sisters. Because when I share my story with my friend at that moment when I was 25, 27 years old, 28 years old, later on, I think someone 2 or 3 years later, he called me and says, yes, I'm going to church regularly, I'm being baptized following week. It is because of you, Jimmy, because you shared your story. People like these personal stories. They trust not the message, they trust you. They trust, your friend doesn't really trust the message. Your friend trusts you going through your life and your message. My brothers and sisters, what is your message? I know you have one. Every one of you have one. Mine is not very extraordinary. It is just my life. Yours doesn't have to be very extraordinary. It is just your life. I encourage you this year not only to find somebody in your life that you can potentially share your life to, deepening your relationship with, but also work out your stories in your small groups. I know you have some small groups. Find a time to do this. It's harder than you think. It really is harder than you think. If you haven't practiced it, do it. Because I know, I've done this through experience. It doesn't come out easy. And it's hard to put it in the frame of shareable within 10 or 15 minutes. I encourage you to do so. And through it, and this is also my personal testimony, when you're working out your story, you'll realize how blessed you are. You'll realize how God has really walked beside you every step of your life. This is not only for the evangelism that we're about to do, but it's also for yourself. As you look at your story, you'll be thinking, thank God for that. Oh, thank God for that. Thank God for that. I did it. That's what happened to me. I encourage you to do so. Don't wait. It's easy to do. There's no research. It's all up here. It's all up here. All you have to do is write it down, share it. Share it with the group here. People who can frame it for you. I said, oh, that's a great story. But if you focus on a little bit this, it'll be more effective. Think about that. Let us pray.